You want to start?
No, yeah, you gotta do the intro.
Oh. I forgot.
Yeah, that's you.
Hey guys! Welcome back to our channel. We started again. Yay! After a while. We did.
We're back. We moved house.
We moved houses. We got some furniture and stuff, so we're okay too.
I can't really see that the city is in the background.
Yes.
Yeah. It probably just looks black. That's
all right. But like in our next videos, we can do it in the worst birthday.
Not for the first time, an argument had broken out over breakfast at number 4 Privet Drive. Mr. Vernon Dursley had been woken in the early hours of the morning by a loud hooting noise from his nephew Harry's room. Third time this week he roared across the table, "If you can't control that owl, it'll have to go." Harry tried yet again to explain. "She's bored," he said. "She's used to flying around outside. If I could just let her out at night." "Do I look stupid?" snarled Uncle Vernon, a bit of fried egg dangling from his bushy moustache. "I know what'll happen if that owl's let out." He exchanged dark looks with his wife, Petunia. Harry tried to argue back, but his words were drowned by a long, loud belch from the Dursley son, Dudley. "I want more bacon." "There's more in the frying pan, sweetums," said Arthur Jr., turning misty-eyed on her massive son. "We must feed you up while we've got the chance. I don't like the sound of that school food." "Nonsense, Petunia. I never went hungry when I was at Smeltings," said Uncle Vernon. "Dudley gets enough, don't you, son?" Dudley, who was so large his bottom drooped over either side of the kitchen chair, grinned and turned to Harry. "Pass the frying pan." "You've forgotten the magic word," said Harry irritably. The effect of this simple sentence on the rest of the family was incredible. Dudley gasped and fell off his chair with a crash that shook the whole kitchen. Mrs. Dursley gave a small scream and clapped her hands to her mouth. Mr. Dursley jumped to his feet, veins throbbing in his temples. "I meant please," said Harry quickly. "I didn't mean..." "What have I told you?" thundered his uncle, spraying spit over the table. "About saying the M-word in this house." "But I..." "How dare you threaten Dudley," roared Uncle Vernon, pounding the table with his fist. I warned you. I will not tolerate mention of your abnormality under the roof." Harry stared from his purple-faced uncle to his pale aunt, who was trying to heave Dudley to his feet. "All right," said Harry. "All right." Uncle Vernon sat back down, breathing like a winded rhinoceros, and watching Harry closely out of the corners of his small, sharp eyes. Ever since Harry had come back home from the summer holidays, Uncle Vernon had been treating him like a bomb that might go off at any moment, because Harry wasn't a normal boy. As a matter of fact, he was as not normal as it is possible to be. Harry Potter was a wizard fresh from his first years at Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, and if the Dursleys were unhappy to have him back for the holidays, it was nothing to how Harry felt. He missed Hogwarts so much, it was like having a constant stomach ache. He missed the castle, with its secret passageways and ghosts, his lessons, though perhaps not Snape, the potions master, the post arriving by owl, eating banquets in the great hall, sleeping in his four-poster bed in the tower dormitory, visiting the gamekeeper, Hagrid, in his cabin in the grounds next to the Forbidden Forest, and especially Quidditch, the most popular sport in Wizarding World. 6 tall goalposts, 4 flying balls, and 14 players on broomsticks. All Harry's spellbooks, his wand, robes, cauldron, and top-of-the-range Nimbus 2000 broomstick, had been locked in a cupboard under the stairs by Uncle Vernon. The instant Harry had come home, what did the Dursleys care if Harry lost his place in the house Quidditch team because he hadn't practiced all summer? What was it to the Dursleys if Harry went back to school without any of his homework done? The Dursleys were what wizards called muggles, not a drop of magical blood in their veins. And as far as they were concerned, having a wizard in the family was a matter of deepest shame. Uncle Vernon had even padlocked Harry's owl, Hedwig, inside her cage.
I don't get that. Why is it a shame? It's such a good thing. It's like having someone in your family that works in NASA or something. It's like really cool. Why would it be a shame?
Jealousy?
Yeah.
They're just stupid. and they like
cry themselves. This is such a cool thing. What's wrong with it?
I don't know. They just in the first book, remember they were talking about how they pride themselves on normalcy, like they're the most normal people in the world. And I think they're just, I don't know.
Ignorance.
Yeah, probably. Well, ignorance is a perfect word for it.
Okay, sorry. I like Vernon, talking between.
Yeah, that's fine. Vernon had even padlocked Harry's owl Hedwig inside her cage to stop her carrying messages to anyone in the wizarding world. Harry looked nothing like the rest of the family. Uncle Vernon was large and neckless, with an enormous black moustache. Aunt Petunia was horse-faced and bony. Dudley was blonde, pink, and porky. Harry, on the other hand, was small and skinny, with brilliant green eyes and jet-black hair that was always untidy. He wore round glasses, and on his forehead was a thin, lightning-shaped scar. It was this scar that made Harry so particularly unusual, even for a wizard. This scar was the only hint of Harry's very mysterious past, of the reason he had been left on the Dursley's doorstep 11 years before. At the age of one, Harry had somehow survived a curse from the greatest dark sorcerer of all time, Lord Voldemort, whose name most witches and wizards still feared to speak. Harry's parents had died in Voldemort's attack, but Harry had escaped with his lightning scar, and somehow, nobody understood why, Voldemort's powers had been destroyed the instant he had failed to kill Harry. So Harry had been brought up by his dead mother's sister and her husband. He had spent 10 years with the Dursleys, never understanding why he kept making odd things happening without meaning to, believing the Dursleys' story that he had got his scar in a car crash which killed his parents. And then, exactly a year ago, Hogwarts had written to Harry, and the whole story had come out. Harry had taken up his place at wizard school, where he and his scar were famous. But now, the school year was over, and he was back with the Dursleys for the summer, back to being treated like a dog that had rolled in something smelly. The Dursleys hadn't even remembered that today happened to be Harry's 12th birthday. Of course, his hopes hadn't been high.
It was exactly like that in the last book.
They'd never given him a proper present, let alone a cake, but to ignore it completely. At that moment, Uncle Vernon cleared his throat importantly and said, "Now, as we all know, today is a very important day." Harry looked up, hardly daring to believe it. "This could well be the day I make the biggest deal of my career," said Uncle Vernon. Harry went back to his toast. Of course, he thought bitterly. Uncle Vernon was talking about the stupid dinner party. He'd been talking of nothing else for a fortnight. Some rich builder and his wife were coming to dinner, and Uncle Vernon was hoping to get a huge order from him.
Yeah, I never knew who they are. Like, I was like, who are they? Like, the next book, the next movie, is the auntie that comes?
Auntie Marge.
Yeah. Like, this one I didn't know.
Uncle Vernon's company made drills. Do you know what the company's called?
No.
Runnings. "I think we should run through the schedule one more time," said Uncle Vernon. "We should all be in position at 8 o'clock. Petunia, you will be?" "In the lounge," said Aunt Petunia promptly, waiting to welcome them graciously into our home. "Good, good. And Dudley?" "I'll be waiting to open the door, Dudley." Put on a foul, simpering smile. "May I take your coats, Mr. and Mrs. Mason?" "Oh, they'll love him," cried Aunt Petunia rapturously. "Excellent, Dudley," said Uncle Vernon. Then he rounded on Harry. "And you?" "I'll be in my bedroom, making no noise, pretending I'm not there," said Harry tonelessly.
Biggest meme ever.
"Exactly," said Uncle Vernon nastily. "I will lead them into the lounge, introduce you, Petunia, and pour them drinks. At 8:15, I'll announce dinner," said Aunt Petunia. "And Dudley, you'll say, 'May I take you through to the dining room, Mrs. Mason?'" said Dudley, offering his fat arm to an invisible woman. "My perfect little gentleman," sniffed Aunt Petunia. "And you?" said Uncle Vernon viciously to Harry. "I'll be in my room, making no noise and pretending I'm not there," said Harry dully. "Precisely. Now, we should aim to get in a good few compliments at dinner, Petunia. Any ideas? Vernon tells me you're a wonderful golfer, Mr. Mason. Do you tell me where you brought your dress, Mrs. Mason?" "Perfect. Dudley, how about..." "We had to write an essay about a hero at school, Mr. Mason, and I wrote about you." This was too much for both Aunt Petunia and Harry. Aunt Petunia burst into tears, and hugged her son, while Harry ducked under the table so they wouldn't see him laughing. And you, boy? Harry fought to keep his face straight as he emerged. I'll be in my room, making no noise and pretending I'm not there. Too right you will, said Uncle Vernon forcefully. The Masons don't know anything about you, and it's going to stay that way. When dinner is over, you take Mrs. Mason back to the lounge for coffee. Petunia and I will bring the subject round to drills. With any luck, I'll have the deal signed and sealed before the news at 10. We'll be shopping for a holiday home in Majora this time tomorrow. Harry couldn't feel too excited about this. He didn't think the Dursleys would like him any better in Majora than they did in Privet Drive.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I'm off into town to pick up the dinner jackets for Dudley and me, and you, he snarled at Harry, you stay out of your aunt's way while she's cleaning. Harry left through the back door. It was a brilliant sunny day. He crossed the lawn, slumped down on the garden bench, and sang underneath his breath. Happy birthday to me.
Aww.
Happy birthday
to me. This wasn't in the movie, was it?
No.
Aww.
No cards, no presents, and he would be spending the evening pretending not to exist. Aww. He gazed miserably into the hedge. He had never felt so lonely. More than anything else at Hogwarts, more even than playing Quidditch, Harry missed his best friends, Ron Weasley and Hermione Granger. They, however, didn't seem to be missing him at all. Neither of them had written to him all summer, even though Ron had said he was going to ask Harry to come and stay. Countless times, Harry had been on the point of unlocking Hedwig's cage by magic and sending her to Ron and Hermione with a letter, but it wasn't worth the risk. Underage wizards weren't allowed to use magic outside school. Harry hadn't told the Dursleys this. He knew it was only their terror that he might turn them all into dung beetles that stopped them locking him in the cupboard under the stairs with his wand and broomstick.
Is he still under the stairs?
No.
No, he has a room.
Yeah. For the first couple of weeks back, Harry had enjoyed muttering nonsense words under his breath and watching Dudley tearing out of the room as fast as his fat legs would carry him. But the long silence from Ron and Hermione had made Harry feel so cut off from the magical world that even taunting Dudley had lost its appeal. And now Ron and Hermione had forgotten his birthday. What wouldn't he give now for a message from Hogwarts, from any witch or wizard? He'd almost be glad of the sight of his arch-enemy, Draco Malfoy, just to be sure it all hadn't been a dream. Not that this whole year at Hogwarts had been fun. At the very end of last term, Harry had come face to face with none other than Lord Voldemort himself. Voldemort might be a ruin of his former self, but he was still terrifying, still cunning, still determined to regain power. Harry had slipped through Voldemort's clutches for a second time, but it had been a narrow escape, and even now, weeks later, Harry kept walking in the night, drenched in cold sweat, wondering where Voldemort was now, remembering his livid face, his wide, mad eyes. Harry suddenly sat bolt upright on the garden bench. He had been staring absent-mindedly into the hedge, and the hedge was staring back. Two enormous green eyes had appeared among the leaves. Harry jumped to his feet just as a jeering voice floated across the lawn. "I know what day it is," sang Dudley, waddling toward him. The huge eyes blinked and vanished. "What?" said Harry, not taking his eyes off the spot where they had been. "I know what day it is," Dudley repeated, coming right up to him. "Well done," said Harry. "So you finally learned the days of the week." "Today's your birthday," sneered Dudley. "How come you haven't got any cards? Haven't got any friends at that freak place?" "Better not let Mum hear you talking about my school," said Harry coolly. Dudley hitched up his trousers, which were slipping down his fat bottom. "Why are you staring at the hedge?" he said suspiciously. "I'm trying to decide what would be the best spell to set it on fire," said Harry. Dudley stumbled backwards at once, a look of panic on his fat face. You can't. Dad told you you're not to do magic. He said he'll chuck you out of the house, and you haven't got anywhere else to go. You haven't got any friends to take you." "Jiggery, pokery," said Harry in a fierce voice. "Hocus, pocus, squiggly, wiggly." "Mum!" howled Dudley, tripping over his feet as he dashed back towards the house. "Mom, he's doing you know what." Harry paid dearly for his moment of fun, as neither Dudley nor the hedge was in any way hurt. Aunt Petunia knew he hadn't really done magic. but he still had to duck as she aimed a heavy blow at his head with the soapy frying pan. Then she gave him work to do, with the promise he wouldn't eat again until he'd finished. While Dudley lolled around watching him and eating ice creams, Harry cleaned the windows, washed the car, mowed the lawn, trimmed the flower beds, pruned and watered the roses, and repainted the garden bench. The sun blazed overhead, burning the back of his neck. Harry knew he shouldn't have risen to Dudley's bait, but Dudley had said the very thing Harry had been thinking himself. Maybe he didn't have any friends at Hogwarts. Wish they could see famous Harry Potter now, he thought savagely as he spread manure on the flower beds, his back aching, sweat running down his face. It was 7:30 in the evening when at last, exhausted, he heard Aunt Petunia calling him. Get in here and walk on the newspaper. Harry moved gladly into the shade of the gleaming kitchen. On top of the fridge stood tonight's pudding, a huge mound of whipped cream and sugared violets. A joint of roast pork was sizzling in the oven. Eat quickly. The Masons will be here soon, snapped Aunt Petunia, pointing to two slices of bread and a lump of cheese on the kitchen table. She was already wearing a salmon pink cocktail dress. Harry washed his hands and bolted down his pitiful supper. The moment he had finished, Aunt Petunia whisked him away. Upstairs, Harry. As he passed the door to the living room, Harry caught a glimpse of Uncle Vernon and Dudley in bow ties and dinner jackets. He had only just reached the upstairs landing when the doorbell rang and Uncle Vernon's furious face appeared at the foot of the stairs. Remember, boy, one sound. Harry crossed to his bedroom on tiptoes, slipped inside, closed the door, and turned to collapse on his bed. The trouble was, there was already someone sitting on it. That's the chapter.
That was a very small chapter.
I'm just going to quickly check how long we've actually been going for, and we might even keep going. Yeah, that was only 20 minutes. Should we keep going?
I don't know, this time we did two chapters, we got really tired.
Yeah, that's true.
And I think we started, so we can start slow, you know?
Yeah, okay. Let's, what did you think?
The only thing that was obvious was that they treated them really bad. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing else. And it was sad that Ron and Hermione didn't write to him.
Didn't write him at all.
Yeah.
What terrible friends.
Yeah.
I wonder why they didn't write him.
Is it a reason?
We'll find out in the next chapter.
Okay.
maybe
the Petunia like got them for herself and like didn't give
took
it
the
to
letters.
Yeah.
Maybe.
And didn't give it to Harry.
What do you think were the eyes in bushes?
Yeah, I saw eyes on the book.
We'll find out.
Voldemort?
It could be Voldemort, you reckon?
Maybe Dumbledore is looking out for Harry?
He would be hiding in bushes, though. He can turn himself invisible.
Maybe it's Ron and Hermione being like, hey! In their own version of kids thing.
You don't think they would say hello?
I'm trying to scare him. I don't know. Okay. I'm just going to put it with I don't know because I don't actually remember the second movie that much to see.
Yeah, but we haven't watched the movies in like a pretty long time. So.
I've seen the second movie so many times, but I can't say a specific thing in it.
Harry being worried about losing his place on the team is pretty funny, considering he's like, I haven't practiced, but like, he literally played last year without even knowing anything about the game.
Yeah.
He's worried about not practicing.
Are other people practicing in summer?
I mean, we know that Ron and like Fred and George and stuff, they have like a Quidditch pitch next to their house.
Yeah, their house.
And they practice, but.
Like, Harry lives amongst like muggles, so he can't do those stuff, but I think Ron can, so I wouldn't worry about that. Oh, come on, Harry.
So they don't know that Harry can't use magic That's absolutely right. But Petunia was Lily's sister.
Yeah.
So was she not allowed to use magic as her school, or did she, or?
I feel like Lily wasn't really close to Petunia, so she wouldn't tell her what the law was. That's what I think.
Yeah.
Because if they were close, she would treat Harry better. Definitely they weren't good sisters. That's why I
think I don't know. That chapter was really just like a recap, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Just, hey, this is what happened in the last book.
Yeah.
Just lots of exposition. Lovely picture. I already showed you that. I don't know if it's going to show up.
Can I say something?
Yep.
I was just really... This chapter was really funny because I was thinking about what's going to happen in the future, what's going to happen to the guests, and it was like, yeah, I saw it. And I was like, oh my god, they're preparing this much for the party, and the cake is just going to fall on their head.
It's pretty in the...
book. Yeah, I thought it's different. I was like waiting for it to be a cake as well, but I noticed that it's a pudding.
They did say it's got a little like whipped cream on it, so.
Yes. Still, pudding looks different than a cake.
The thing in the movie just looks like the whole thing is cream. Yeah, the host is all cream.
Yeah.
It's got like cherries on it. It looks awful. I wouldn't eat it. That's it.
It's okay, some videos can be small.
Yeah, no, well, because I figured we're into Chamber of Secrets where, like, J.K. Rowling's actually...
on a roll?
Yeah, she's on a roll. She's rolling. so, yeah, I don't know.
It's okay, we'll...
Next few chapters will be more.
Upload sooner. We will read this sooner.
We did get a lovely comment from somebody. I'll just get them up.
A new fan.
Yeah. Yeah, we've got a lovely comment from an Andrew Bright.
Thank you, Andrew.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. We are back. We're making chapters. Maybe we even went a little bit quicker because we were like, oh, there's somebody waiting.
Two people now.
Two people. We've got two fans now.
Like, besides our family and close friends. So, I guess, is that it? But yes. Thank you guys for watching. We'll be back soon.
Sooner,
if it's small. So, read more, because some of our assessments are done. We're happy. Yay! So, okay. See you guys. Bye!
See ya.
Good.
Yeah, I really
want to
know what that
was,
though.
I like small ones. What's wrong?